Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Politics of Disinformation, edited by Guillermo Lopez Garcia, Dolors Palau Sampio, Bella Palomo, Eva Campos Dominguez, and Pere Masip. Narrated by Asa Siegel. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. Concerns about disinformation have witnessed extraordinary growth since the mid-2010s, despite the spread of false and distorted messages in the public arena not being a new phenomenon. In 2016, the Oxford Dictionary declared post-truth its word of the year, highlighting a historical and political time in which disinformation strategies reached new heights, fueled by the hybridization of the communicative ecosystem in a context of increasing polarization and populism. The election of Donald Trump in 2016 and the Brexit referendum the same year were milestones in the awareness of the role that manipulative messages play and their effects on political decisions, particularly in times of crisis. Disinformation strategies take advantage of social networks to go viral quickly and benefit from another of these networks' inherent characteristics: their ability to discriminate and stratify the public according to the most diverse criteria. Any person or company with a sufficiently large and specialized database can now distribute content among the public according to multiple criteria, allowing much more to be known about their tastes, hobbies, opinions, etc., than in the past. In fact, data on the public's participation on social networks, who they follow, in which groups they participate, what content they share, etc., are one of the main elements that help increase the effectiveness of the messages sent to the public. The snowball of disinformation can, in fact, sustain itself and improve its effectiveness in each wave. The potential of social networks to disseminate disinformation rises in importance while their role as main sources of information gains strength, especially during electoral processes. Given that disinformation takes advantage of increasingly polarized public opinion, its pernicious effects on political debate and decision-making demand greater knowledge of the reasoning behind the dissemination of disinformation. Post-truth consequences in democracy have received much social, political, and academic attention in recent years. This book is a collection of international studies that are representative of leading research focusing on disinformation. It is structured in parts that correspond to the book's four main objectives. First, to offer theoretical approaches to disinformation. Second, to analyze the role of disinformation in politics. Third, to expand on disinformation fact-checking strategies. And finally, to further explore the exposure and effects of disinformation. The three chapters included in Part 1 of the book provide the theoretical basis to understand disinformation. In Disinformation Matters, Analyzing the Academic Production, Chapter 1, Nereida Sea and Bella Palomo explain how this topic has become a fertile priority and worldwide line of research. In A Materialist Approach to Fake News, Chapter 2, Thales Lelo and Roseli Figaro systematize the main trends in current scholarship regarding fake news to propose a materialistic approach to the issue. They try to elucidate socio-historical aspects that connect fake news with profound transformations in capital accumulation cycles. Chapter 3, Using International Relations Theories to Understand Disinformation, Soft Power, Narrative Turns, and New Wars, by Giuseppe Anzera and Alessandra Massa, describes how disinformation is affected by long-standing trends and the competitive manipulation of information through actions designed to reshape reality to attain political goals. Part 2, Disinformation in Politics, focuses on recent international cases of disinformation in political campaigns. Rose Marie Santini, Julia Tucci, Deborah Salles, and Alda Rosana D. de Almeida analyze the role of instant messaging services that enable disinformation to be spread during elections. In Do You Believe in Fake After All? WhatsApp Disinformation Campaign During the 2018 Brazilian Presidential Election, Chapter 4. Mastuki, in Chapter 5, The Politics of Disinformation in Indonesia, 2014 through 2019, examines the growth of disinformation practices in developing democracies, such as Indonesia, and the detrimental effects of fake news, hoaxes, and misleading information in election years. The next chapter, Ideology and Disinformation, How False News Stories Contributed to Brexit, Chapter 6, by Imke Henkel, offers an insight into how British newspapers, notably the tabloid press, filled their pages with hostility toward European institutions for decades and influenced public opinion on Brexit. Lorena Cano Oron, Herman Yorca Abad, and Guillermo Lopez Garcia close this part of the book with Chapter 7, Spanish Politicians Dealing with Fake News in the April 2019 General Election. Aiming to detect the creation and spread of fake news on Twitter by Spanish political parties during the April 2019 general election campaign. Part 3, Fact-Checking in Politics, emphasizes the role of several initiatives that have been implemented to combat disinformation. Dolors, Palau Sampio, and Adolfo Caratala compare three fact-checking projects in Checking Verifications, Focus and Scope of Collaborative Projects to Monitor Election Campaigns in France, Brazil, and Spain, Chapter 8, to delve into the aims and limitations that they present. Tomás Dodds in Structures of Resistance, Citizen-Generated Reporting in Times of Social Unrest, Chapter 9, examines the practices that emerged from civil society to fight against disinformation and fake news in Chile during the so-called October Revolution. The waves of anti-government protests and cultural manifestations across the country. Eva Campos Dominguez, Cristina Renedo Farpón, Daphne Calvo, and Maria Díez Garrido focus on automated verification to discover how political parties and fact-checking organizations in Spain deal with disinformation during electoral campaigns and the appropriateness of the adopted measures. In Robot Strategies for Combating Disinformation in Election Campaigns, a Fact-Checking Response from Parties and Organizations, Chapter 10. The last chapter of this part of the book, That Prodigious Machinery Designed to Exclude, The Discourse of Post-Truth in Algorithmic Culture, Chapter 11, by Jakub Novak, offers a theoretical approach to the post-truth phenomenon as being inherently tied to how digital public spheres work by tracking its connections with the transformation of media markets and changing patterns of news distribution. Finally, Part 4, The Effects of Disinformation on Everyday Life, includes three chapters that address different perspectives on exposure to disinformation. In Teens, Social Media, and Fake News, A User's Perspective, Chapter 12, Aidy Mersenier, Victor Wired, and Marie Dufresne analyze how teenagers receive, perceive, and interact with fake news on social media, drawing on focus groups composed of high school students. Carlos Rodriguez Perez and Gustavo R. Garcia Vargas, in Understanding Which Factors Promote Exposure to Online Disinformation, Chapter 13, examine the conditions under which citizens are more resilient or more likely to be associated with exposure to and concern about online disinformation in 4 Latin American countries and 17 Western democracies. The final chapter, Rumoring, Disinformation, and Contentious Politics in the Digital Age, The Case of China and Beyond, Chapter 14, by Jun Liu, presents an alternative understanding of rumor as disinformation, focusing on contentious politics in an authoritarian context like the People's Republic of China. This book is dedicated to one of its co-editors, Professor Dr. Pere Masip, who passed away on July 18, 2021. Pere was an inspiring teacher and a rigorous researcher with vast knowledge. He had an insatiable intellectual curiosity that emerged from his wide-ranging education in archaeology, documentation, and journalism. His thoroughness, search for excellence, enormous capacity for work, and passion for research allowed him to easily lead projects and build cross-border networks and initiatives, which came together through digital journalism. His skills forged a professional reputation that has left an enduring legacy at his university and were surpassed only by his human qualities and enormous generosity with colleagues and students, because Pere Masip was one of those people who made this world better. For us, the other co-editors of this book, the death of our colleague Pere has been a tremendous and unexpected shock because, despite the seriousness of his illness, we had been affected by his optimism for recovery. He threw himself into his academic work with enthusiasm and commitment until the end. He had suggested we create this book, a project about which he was enormously excited, after attending the 2019 IAMCR pre-conference in Valencia, Disinformation and Political Processes, Media Strategies and Audience Attitudes, which also arose from his inexhaustible energy and generosity. It has been a joy and a privilege to know, learn from, work, and live with Professor Pere Masip. His premature passing has affected us all. His memory will endure in his work, in all the many people who knew him, and in our hearts. Pere, thank you for your help and for inspiring and guiding us for so many years. Part 1. Theoretical Approaches to Disinformation. 1. Disinformation Matters, Analyzing the Academic Production, Nereda Sea and Bela Palomo, University of Malaga, Spain. Introduction. The experts predict that in 2022, the citizens of developed countries will be consuming more disinformation than genuine news, because lies are 70% more likely to go viral and be retweeted in comparison with verified information. It is estimated that 115 fabricated stories favoring Donald Trump were shared on Facebook a total of 30 million times during the 2016 U.S. presidential election. This figure confirms the impact attained by isolated content disseminated on alternative rather than traditional news channels. This is shaping a dangerous news diet that can generate distrust toward the media and damage the democratic quality of society by encouraging civic apathy, destabilization, chaos, a reduction of pluralism, and a strengthening of polarized communities in which fake news and conspiracy theories are freely propagated. Specialized approaches also warn of a decline of scientific culture in the age of fake news, threatening the scientific and economic progress of Western countries. Audiences are conscious of the ambiguity, lack of control, and weakness that accompany the hybrid media system in which such practices have come to maturity. This is why one of their main concerns is the manipulation of journalistic news stories to serve political or economic interests, as the Reuters Institute Digital News Report testified in 2018. This panorama explains why disinformation has become the principal challenge and concern in communication in the 21st century, and why its transmedia and cross-border dimension requires public policies and specific training in order to limit its spread. The scientific community has reacted actively, since academic attention can contribute to sustainable digital development by designing solutions that lead to an innovative society that is also reflexive, responsible, and secure in the context of an unprecedented transformation in communication patterns. This chapter confirms that studies linked to disinformation have become a fertile and priority line of research. This intensity of production respects the proposal made by the High-Level Group on Fake News and Online Information of the European Commission to formulate continuous investigation on the issue in order to evaluate the measures adopted by the different actors. Mapping recent developments in the scholarship on fake news and misinformation has previously been undertaken in the sphere of health, selectively in the area of communication, and by applying an interdisciplinary approach that involved disciplines like psychology, economics, and political science, as well as communication, analyzing investigations registered on the databases of Web of Science, Scopus, Google Scholar, and PubMed. The novelty of the present chapter lies in the breadth of the sample used, since previous review articles had examined between 2 and 142 journal articles. Methodical approach. 40 years after the publication of the first articles indexed in Web of Science related to disinformation, it seems timely to construct an X-ray of its presence in academic research in order to objectively set out the scope achieved. To this end, a mixed methodology is applied, which combines bibliographical and bibliometric analysis to gather qualitative and quantitative data, enabling the volume and impact of scientific publications to be measured. This chapter therefore aims to analyze the scientific production on disinformation issues published in journals indexed in the Web of Science Core Collection, WOS, without any temporal restriction, that is, from 1900 until August 2020. The sample was put together on the basis of articles housed in the Social Sciences Citation Index, SSCI, database, which is the most relevant and pertinent index for the area of communication. Following the analysis of the conceptual articles related to disinformation, a list of terms used for the consultation was designed. The following search string was applied: disinformation, or misinformation, or misleading information, or manipulated new, or fake new, or fact check, or false content, or false new, or post-truth, or verification tool, or verif process, or information disorder, or hybrid media system. This search was conducted on the titles, abstracts, and keywords of the articles published by all SSCI publications, without considering book reviews or proceedings. Initially, 536 references were localized in the general category of social sciences, and this list was subjected to a bibliometric analysis referring to the following indicators: temporal evolution, authorship, affiliation, language, country of production, journal, and most cited articles. A codifier examined all the articles in full, eliminated reiterations, and for the content analysis selected only those empirical investigations whose pivotal issue was disinformation, obtaining a final sample of 434 articles. In addition, a deductive codebook was implemented, and labels created manually on Zotero were applied in order to classify and categorize the information. In this second phase, the registered variables belonged to the following categories: 1. Theme, 2. Subtheme, 3. Platform analyzed, 4. Methodological focus, and 5. Tools employed. The thematic classification used a standard taxonomy proposed by the International Communication Association, ICA, which establishes 24 sections within the communication area. This book presents a chronological evolution of the interest that disinformation has aroused in the academic sphere, which journals have provided more extensive coverage, the most productive geographical areas, the most cited works, the most outstanding authors and their affiliations, the co-authorships generated, the approaches addressed, and the methodologies employed in these investigations. Results. Bibliometric analysis. A quantitative analysis of the keywords introduced in searches for articles in WOS made it possible to observe the conceptual preferences of the researchers. Terminologically, fake news headed the ranking as the most used keyword. 199 articles, as shown in Figure 1.1, followed by misinformation, 189, disinformation, 111, post-truth, 105, fact check, 79, hybrid media system, 35, misleading information, 11, false news, 10, verification process, 4, manipulated news, 2, information disorder, 1, fact-checking platform, 1, and false content, 1. A cross-analysis by area also revealed some interesting contrasts, such as that the word misinformation is more frequently used in psychology and political sciences, while fake news and fact check are more usual in communication. A longitudinal study of the use of these concepts in the academic literature evinces the growing interest in this area of investigation, especially from 2016 onwards, when post-truth was chosen as word of the year due to the notoriety it had achieved during the Brexit referendum and the U.S. presidential election, which resulted in the appearance of numerous publications from 2017 onwards. Although mentions in the academic record dating back 4 decades have been localized, these studies were carried out sporadically. Proof of this is that up until 2012, 1 or 2 articles at the most appeared each year, which contrasts with the 179 new publications registered in 2019 alone, accounting for 1/3 of the sample. The COVID-19 crisis has significantly influenced the level of production, continuously accelerating the various phases involved in publication, which is why it is foreseeable that at the end of 2020, the number of articles and publications registered will be higher than that achieved the previous year. With respect to searching for concepts to determine their longevity, analysis of the texts indexed in WOS confirms that in 1980, the first article appeared that included the word fact check in its title. It was published in the professional journal Columbia Journalism Review, and described and compared the work developed by fact-checkers in U.S. newsrooms. In 1983, a newspaper chronicle by Robert Kaplan tackled disinformation in Greece in pioneering fashion in that same journal, and in the 1990s, several authors analyzed the news coverage of AIDS, some of which was considered deliberate misinformation. However, fake news, currently the most widespread term of those analyzed, was not used until 2005. The texts that appear in this paragraph and other similar ones have been excluded from the qualitative analysis of this chapter as they lack an explicit methodology, but they must be mentioned because they show the existence of a historical debate within the journalistic profession on the veracity of content, although that concern has intensified and been addressed with greater scientific rigor more recently. The current stage has also favored the emergence of new concepts, such as junk news, which refers to sources that deliberately publish misleading, deceptive, or incorrect information packaged as real news, or newsness, the extent to which audiences characterize specific content as news. In this context, there is a predominance of articles with multiple authorship, 70%, a decision that is probably justified by the complexity of the phenomenon and a multidisciplinary approach. This analysis makes it possible to compile the list of the most productive and reputed authors in this line of research, led by 3 women, Emily Vraga, 13 articles, Letitia Bodhi, 8, and Michelle Amazine, 7. Followed by Lucas Graves, Michael Hameliers, Edson C. Tandock Jr., 6, H. Lee, Richard Ling, and Chris Wells, 5. In terms of affiliation, 14 universities account for 1/4 of the entire production analyzed, with North American institutions occupying a dominant position. Outstanding in this respect is the University of Wisconsin, where the greatest number of articles registered in WOS, 22, are generated, followed by the Universities of Boston, 15, Pennsylvania Commonwealth System of Higher Education, London, 12, George Mason, Minnesota, Austin, Texas, 11, Georgetown, Harvard, Northwestern, Ohio State, Amsterdam, Oxford, and in Singapore, Nanyang Technology University, 10. This domination of the research influences the language that predominates in the articles. 91% of production is in English, 487 articles, while Spanish comes a long way behind with 41 articles, 7.6%. With insignificant percentages, there are 3 articles in German, another 3 in Russian, 1 in Slovene, and another in Catalan. In keeping with the geographical distribution of universities, the countries that show the greatest number of academic publications related to the issue are led by the United States, 45.5% of the articles analyzed, followed by the United Kingdom, 11.8%, and Spain, 11%. Nonetheless, the proof that disinformation is a global and widespread concern lies in the fact that the investigations originate from some 50 countries, amongst which the European continent takes on an important role, as 45.8% of those countries are located there. The total number of journals from the communication field that have published research related to disinformation is 64. Journals housing more than 5% of the total publications were considered to be the most committed to this issue. Making calls for special issues has an influence on this. The most active are El Profesional de la Información and Social Media Plus Society, which surpass 30 registers each, New Media and Society, and the International Journal of Communication, 26, and Digital Journalism, 24, Journalism Practice, 23, Information Communication and Society, and Political Communication, 20, come close to these figures. The exponential growth experienced in recent years by studies on disinformation has also had a positive influence on their impact. As a general figure, the average number of citations and other high-impact publications obtained per article in Web of Science is 8.6. Table 1.3 shows the 5 most cited articles, characterized by their addressing contexts and employing diverse methodologies, although politics is the central pivot in 3 of the investigations. The most referenced amongst them is The Daily Show, Discursive Integration and the Reinvention of Political Journalism, a classic case study of the discipline that pioneered the use of fake news. Close behind is a recently published conceptual investigation, the work of Tandock et al., titled Defining Fake News, A Typology of Scholarly Definitions, which in only 2 years has achieved 219 citations, thanks to the taxonomy proposed. The third article is an essay that analyzes Donald Trump's Twitter feed and concludes that his success is due to simple, impulsive, and uncivil discourses. The fourth place is occupied by Engesser et al., who develop a qualitative study on the rise of populism on Facebook and Twitter, comparing 4 scenarios: Austria, Italy, Switzerland, and United Kingdom. Also on this list is an article that, by employing experimental techniques based on exposing users to misinformation content, evaluates the cognitive processes involved in processing verification and analyzes the incidence of corrections in the perception of news. With respect to the analysis of co-citation implemented with the VOS Viewer application, 5 research clusters can be observed, connected by Edson Tandock as the central node. Bibliographic analysis. Politics, the realm of disinformation. An initial content analysis of the articles examined shows that they address a broad variety of themes. Although 4 areas account for 93% of the articles: political communication, 37.56%, mass communication, 36.18%, journalism studies, 12.44%, and health communication, 6.91%. The search for the causes and consequences of disinformation in the political sphere has been undertaken in numerous countries, but the majority of studies focus on the United States. Rajecki and Meras, 2016, are the authors of one of the pioneering studies on misinformation, in which they analyze facts, half-truths, and untruths during the presidential election of 2004. They conclude that by itself the web is not sufficient for spreading misinformation, but it can influence or set the agenda for traditional media. for the 2008 election, in which Obama confronted McCain, Weeks and Garrett carried out a national telephone survey to examine the consequences of inaccurate political rumors and found that believing rumors about an opposed candidate reinforced a vote for the preferred candidate. In the 2012 election, there was a tendency to analyze activity on Twitter, where Republicans evinced stronger outgroup negativity and hostility toward fact-checkers than Democrats. However, the scientific production that accompanied the 2016 presidential election was more fertile because the disinformation order generated an unprecedented Democratic disruption. These strategies have made Trump a referent in studies on disinformation. He is mentioned in 200 articles, 45.9% of the sample. The case of Brazil has also attracted academic interest, especially due to the rise of right-wing extremist Jair Bolsonaro to the presidency and the resentment toward the Partido dos Trabalhadores, which were achieved by publishing messages in Facebook and WhatsApp groups. This alienation was also reproduced in Germany, where Zimmermann and Koering, 2020, showed the direct relation existing between media, politics, and disinformation, confirming that the less one trusts in news, media, and politics, the more one believes in online disinformation. The emergence of these extremist movements online has given rise to permanent vigilance among the population in places like India as well. But simultaneously, many citizens are complicit with disinformation techniques, as could be seen in the 2017 UK general election campaign. Apart from electoral periods, authoritarian countries, referendums, and territorial conflicts such as those between Russia and Ukraine, or the independence of Catalonia, have also given rise to waves of disinformation and relevant studies. Special mention is merited by comparative cross-national approaches, which have identified tendencies derived from exposure to disinformation in Africa as well, although the most extensive investigation was carried out by Humprecht et al., who empirically examined 18 Western democracies, which they catalog according to their high or low resilience to online disinformation. Besides the predominant themes, the articles in the sample present a wide variety in their choices of media for study, which is a reflection of the indiscriminate expansion of disinformation. The majority of studies use multimedia approaches, 60.1%, in which they combine analysis of social media, online newspapers, legacy media, and/or content from radio or television. In second place, there are the investigations focusing exclusively on social media, 26.5%. Within this group, one in three works focuses on the disinformation found on Twitter. This quantity of production is due to two basic reasons. First, Twitter's application programming interface, API, makes it possible to download and analyze conversations that involve an extensive number of tweets. And second, it is the social media that journalists prefer. Studies focusing on YouTube, WhatsApp, Telegram, or WeChat are exceptional and only account for 5% of total production. Methodological trends. An analysis of the methodologies used in studies on disinformation shows that a qualitative approach is the most widely used, 55.5%, followed by the quantitative approach, 32%, and mixed solutions, 12.4%. Additionally, there is a greater proliferation of single-method studies. Contributions that focus on reviews of the literature or essays, which are often difficult to distinguish, have been the most numerous, 27%, and correspond to an initial stage marked by a concern for conceptual precision, with complex equivalences in the different languages. The most widely used instruments for data gathering are the survey, 29.4%, and content analysis, 21.7%. The majority of surveys are conducted using an online panel, making use of companies that specialize in market studies to ensure high participation. One of those most utilized by researchers is Amazon Mechanical Turk, or MTurk. But others also appear on the list, like Qualtrics, GFK, YouGov, and Nielsen IBOPE. Only Weeks and Garrett, 2014, have had recourse to telephone surveys, which they used to analyze rumors during the 2008 presidential campaign in the United States. Technological advance has facilitated the use of tools for gathering massive data, which speeds up content analysis. Several authors use Media Cloud, an open-source platform for media analysis. Monitoring news coverage is complemented by the identification of keywords, the creation of word clouds, word counts, and even geocoding all the stories and showing the results on a map. To recover historical archives published in a web format, they have recourse to archive.org, although some studies use the database of the GDELT project, which extracts content from Google News. Resources used for social media monitoring include BrandWatch or Netlytic, a cloud-based analyzer that uses public APIs to collect posts from Twitter and YouTube. Botometer enables the detection of possible messages by bots. For analyzing social media, they also use UCNet, Gephi, and Node.xl. Regarding the software that enables data to be stored, transcribed, and codified, mention is made in the sample of some as well-known as Atlas.ti, NVivo, and MaxQDA. R is also employed for computational text analysis. Additionally, the majority of the statistical analyses use SPSS software. New opportunities for research. The two basic approaches found are descriptive investigations that explain the problem and experimental studies that make it possible to detect possible solutions. In contrast to the profusion of pragmatic studies that identify and quantify the effects and consequences of disinformation and postulate models, there is a scarcity of works that analyze the legislative frameworks and communication policies generated, such as the initiatives promoted by the European Union. Other minority approaches are those relating socio-demographic variables to the level of media literacy and their incidence in the consumption of disinformation, or relating to how different population groups perceive the work of verification platforms. Approaches from visual communication, prospective investigations, and works referring to newsroom self-criticism and internal debates in the media about the harm caused to them by disseminating false content are non-existent in spite of the fact that disinformation has been the subject of editorial pieces. These academic challenges could mark the future of investigative production on disinformation questions, which are expected to be long-lasting and worrying when facing the development of artificial intelligence and the appearance of deep fakes. 2. A Materialist Approach to Fake News. Tales Lelo and Rosselli Figaro, University of São Paulo, Brazil. Introduction. In recent years, the literature concerned with the spread of so-called fake news has grown because this notion highlights the uncertainty surrounding the interference of disinformation in elections, e.g. the election of Donald Trump in the U.S. in 2016 and the Brexit referendum that same year. Scholars initially used this concept in the early 2000s to discuss talk shows that mimicked journalistic discourse to satirize socially relevant topics, for instance, The Daily Show from Comedy Central. However, there are currently many studies conceptualizing political disinformation in academic research. Given that representative democracy presupposes a well-informed and rational citizenry to participate in decision-making processes, fake news constitutes a political pathology because it would poison the well of the deliberative democracy. As the current trend in the scholarly literature on fake news has peaked in parallel with the surge of disinformation in the political environment, the primary focus of this field has centered on developing analytical tools to further studies dedicated to textual specificities, digital infrastructure, and the broader effects of fake news on the public sphere. In this chapter, we systematize the current scholarly trends regarding fake news to propose a materialistic approach to the issue. We aim to elucidate socio-historical aspects that underpin the ongoing surge of online disinformation, but often remain unclear in extant literature. Although the public debate surrounding fake news emerges along with the crisis in Western democracy and the rise of the social media platforms, they are connected with profound transformations in capital accumulation cycles. In our opinion, these transformations have modified the informational flux and, consequently, have sustained the prevailing disinformation stream. We develop our argument based on 25 articles about fake news published in academic journals between 2017 and 2019. During this time, scholarly literature related to political disinformation has significantly expanded. To compose this research corpus, we employed two complementary selection criteria. First, from some of the highest-ranked journals on the SIMAGO Journal Rank Indicator, e.g. New Media and Society, Digital Journalism, Inquiry, Information, Communication and Society. We examined articles related to the subject published in the last 3 years. We then added highly cited articles related to fake news published in journals that were not previously considered in our list to our sample. In our categorization, the latest studies in this field should be segmented into descriptive and epistemic efforts to look at fake news. Our classification complements those proposed by Tandock Jr. et al. And Egeloffer and Leckler. Following the literature review outlined in the first section, we advance our materialistic approach to fake news. The main aim is to improve on a previously underdeveloped perspective on our current disinformation order, connected with ongoing discussions regarding platform capitalism. From a Marxist viewpoint recently covered by this line of studies of platforms, it is necessary to stress the historical transformations that have turned low-quality content into a valuable resource to keep the capital accumulation cycle in full swing. Acknowledging that fake news can be found in even the most celebrated era of the printing press, and for this reason cannot be viewed as a new phenomenon, we emphasize how journalism is, step by step, aligning itself to the financial parameters of platform conglomerates. As a result, nowadays, fake news is just a cheaper way to attract web traffic, and consequently to manufacture data, than journalistic information. Scholarly trends in fake news literature. The growing academic research on fake news has been split between two main branches. On the one hand, scholars acknowledge the relevance of fake news in discussing the challenges to Western democracy, improving empirical research on the issue, especially in the digital environment. On the other hand, some social epistemologists claimed the term's abandonment, arguing that it has been adopted as a discursive weapon by authoritarian governments to thwart freedom of expression, to cover up bad ideology. Characterizations of fake news. Most research on fake news comes from theoretical approaches that claim a stricter definition of the notion than its prevalent vagueness in public discourse. Such studies have claimed a necessary elucidation of fake news to distinguish it from related notions. Accordingly, fake news should not be confounded with rumors and conspiracy theories because they can be based on either false or real stories. Researchers argue that fake news strictly rests on disinformation, regardless of the author's intent. However, in some instances, the source's intent must be considered because fake news cannot be conflated with satire and parody. While the last two are promoted as entertainment to their audiences, often by comedians, the first is offered as information, misleading some of the public. In addition, although the concept has been employed to qualify propaganda disguised as news stories, for instance, press releases conveyed as information by authoritarian governments, a growing body of studies does not conflate fake news with propaganda. Scholars have highlighted that fake news does not necessarily foster an ideology, e.g., bullshit utterances covered up as news publications to generate revenue by increasing web traffic. Likewise, journalistic error is not fake news in this stricter scholarly definition because it usually derives from unintended mistakes or a poor fact-checking process. Disinformation could be considered fake news insofar as it is misleading by design. Studies, whose primary purpose is to define fake news, try to specify why this notion cannot merely be replaced by disinformation, a concept with a more stable scholarly definition. Despite both terms referring to utterances without commitment to truth and capable of misleading their target audiences, disinformation is not necessarily delivered as news in the manner that fake news is. Disinformation, disguised as a media report, mimics the appearance of established news sources to gain people's trust. Ultimately, fake news takes advantage of readers' naivety for political or economic reasons, e.g., to promote an ideology, to generate income from clickbait. These scholars disagree about the historical roots of fake news and frequently do not dig into this issue. While some authors have contended that this disinformation subgenre was born in digital media, others have signaled the existence of fake news in past centuries. Moreover, they also disagree about the relationship between the rise of fake news and the downturn of journalistic credibility in recent years. Infrastructure studies. Additionally, several scholars have analyzed the social media platforms, the algorithms, and the socio-political environment that set up the dissemination of falsehoods disguised as news. This research is not primarily centered on the characterization of fake news, but on the environment surrounding its production and circulation in the public sphere. It discusses how the emergence of programmatic advertising is responsible for the surge of low-quality digital content created to generate income from users' clicks. Since effective charged content usually elicits public engagement on social media, purveyors of fake news have a fertile ground on which to fabricate appealing stories to attract users' interest. Besides, the socio-political background is taken into account in studies that claim the context-sensitive nature of fake news. Nevertheless, even this line of research lacks a historical perspective that links the macro changes in capital modes of production and circulation and their impact on the epistemic environment. This further elucidation could explain the financial dynamics behind the social media platforms that foster fake news. Estimated and evaluated effects. Another trend in the descriptive approach has paid attention to the effects of fake news on the cognitive level. While some studies have described the estimated effects of this type of disinformation on citizens, especially on sensitive political issues, a growing amount of experimental research has produced mixed results regarding the negative impacts of fake news on deliberative processes. Studies focusing on the estimated effects of fake news mainly come from social epistemology. According to these scholars, the social media ecosystem has heightened the adverse effects of disinformation since it potentially amplifies the reach of stories posted by its users. Additionally, platforms assist purveyors of fake news by addressing their content toward those partisan audiences who are most susceptible to their beliefs and share their publications. Consequently, people who believe in fake news are less capable of making good choices related to their epistemic environment because these false stories often collide with reports diffused by reliable institutions, e.g., mainstream news media, science. However, the experimental research so far has shown mixed results that do not necessarily correspond to the negative tone shared by social epistemologists regarding the presumed adverse effects of fake news on the public sphere. Broader studies about the spread of false stories have shown that this type of content circulates much less than expected, even during elections. Vargo et al. Also demonstrated that fake news influenced the agenda of only the alternative right-wing media in the U.S. media landscape from 2014 to 2016. Until now, some studies have suggested that the circulation of fake news is often limited to individuals who are highly committed to burning social issues. That is, engagement with fake news content is restricted to a subset of heavy internet users with a high availability for media consumption. Partisanship has been considered a particularly potent moral disposition that separates people from factual information, especially when that information challenges their initial preferences. Therefore, Demagoguery could be more appealing for a few citizens than factual and accurate information, especially when it reinforces their pre-existent worldviews. Scholars have argued that individuals who are susceptible to trusting political elites are more likely to believe in fake news. Likewise, the more partisan a citizen is, the more likely they are to consider themselves and their comrades impervious to disinformation. However, even research connecting fake news with the older phenomenon of partisanship lacks a concern with the material conditions that increase the circulation of disinformation in unstable political contexts. Although political elites' propagandistic use of social media platforms to circumvent journalism contributes to our epistemic environment's pollution, we argue that this situation was only possible due to changes in the capital accumulation cycle. Epistemic critical approaches. Conversely, the last of the current approaches to fake news has been the claiming of the terms abandonment, arguing that it has been used as a discursive weapon by authoritarian governments to thwart freedom of expression, to cover up bad ideology. Albeit from a critical perspective, these scholars move away from all descriptive approaches since they consider fake news to be either an epistemic slur or a floating signifier, usually evoked to undermine trust in democracy and the press. Since Donald Trump's election in 2016, other demagogues worldwide have been blaming their critics, mainly from mainstream news media, for conveying fake news. Judicial efforts to pass fake news laws to fight against online disinformation have come under criticism regarding their insufficient definition of fake news. As a result, these laws could be exploited by elites to curtail government opposition. Epistemic criticism of the scholarly literature about fake news revolves around negating any real phenomenon behind the term. Although we could follow the historical roots of propaganda and disinformation, fake news would not have a stable meaning that would allow scholars to base their research on it. Thus, critics of fake news conceptualization argue that there is no feasible way to advance a descriptive approach without being trapped in undemocratic purposes. Nevertheless, even though we agree that the term fake news has been used as a discursive artifice to undermine public dissent, we also contend that this notion cannot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.